a joint work with Univ from the Chinese University of Hong Kong. And this paper is about clustering visualization. First of all, let me show you some ideas about clustering visualization. Here is a two-dimensional data set. At the first glance, there were three clusters, right? Because at a certain granularity level, these three groups of points can be regarded as far apart from each other. And thus, they are three clusters. However, if you look at this, this data set at a closer level, and namely that you just zoom out a little bit, then essentially these two groups of points can be regarded as a cluster. And another one is this one. And if you imagine that you keep zooming out, then eventually all the points in the data set belong to just one cluster. Therefore, the clustering result essentially depends on the what granularity level you are looking at the data set. And this is very important to choose an appropriate granularity level to obtain a desired clustering result. However, this is not an easy job, simply because the granularity level is highly data dependent. Therefore, to achieve this progress, clustering visualization is a powerful tool to do this job. Here is an optics diagram, a clustering visualization of these different data sets, output by the popular method optics, where the x-axis coordinate and you enumerate all the points in the data set. And the y-axis represents a spectrum of the granularity level. I will specify what exactly is. And here, if you cut this diagram at this granularity level, say 0.05 horizontally, then you will get three rallies here, each of which corresponds to one cluster, meaning that at this granularity level, there are three clusters in the dataset. And if you cut this diagram horizontally at 0.1, then you will get two rallies. The first rally consists of these two small rallies, and the other is the green one. And it means that at this granularity level, there are two clusters in the data set. These two groups merge together to one cluster. Therefore, users can easily use this diagram to choose the granularity level to obtain the clustering result that fits the application need. Since this is just an artificial data set, let me show you the optics diagram on real data set. This is an optics diagram of a household data set, which is a real data set. And now if the user wants to obtain some cluster, then with some certain size, sizable clusters, then he probably wants to cut the diagram through here, then each of these rallies corresponds to a cluster. And if he wants to get some smaller and finer cluster, then he probably wants to cut the diagram at this level. Despite the nice property of the optics diagram, the current best time complexity for computing the optics diagram is quadratic, meaning that a quadratic to the number of the points in the dataset, which is a disaster for large datasets, right? And to remedy this issue, there exists some approximate algorithms to do so. However, none of these algorithms can guarantee that the output diagram has the quality guarantee. Namely, that the resemblance of the approximate diagram comparing to the exact one. So, in other words, essentially now you have to face such a dilemma. On one hand, if you go for the accuracy, then you have to pay the quadratic cost. And on the other hand, if you go for the efficiency, you have to take a risk to make a wrong decision, misled by a poor quality diagram. So you have to choose either one of these two options. And in our paper, we offer you the third choice, by which you can kill the two birds with one stone. Here, this is our the diagram outputted by our approximate algorithms. with the approximation ratio parameter set to 0.1%, which is a very small perturbation. And as you can see, the two diagrams are highly similar. Except in fact, we can show that the resemblance between the two diagrams is mathematically provably small. What's more, such a diagram can be computed in just n log n time. It dramatically brings down the projective running time to just n log n. This is what I'm going to talk about in this talk. First of all, let me introduce some notations. In the following, we will use P to denote a set of n points in d-dimensional space, and we use B, P, epsilon to denote the ball centered at the point P with radial epsilon. And we call this ball is the vicinity of the point P. Okay. The underlying clustering semantic is a DB scan cluster. There are two parameters in DB scan. The first one is epsilon, which is a real value, and it controls the granularity levels for the cluster. And the second one is mean points, which is a constant integer, at least one. DB scan enforces two rules. The rule number one is that if a point in the dataset whose vicinity covers at least mean points, then this point P is called an epsilon core point. Rule number two, if a point P is an epsilon core point, then all the points within its vicinity must belong to the same cluster as P. So you can imagine that to form a DB scan cluster, you can start with an empty set and pick an arbitrary epsilon core point, and then add all the points within the vicinity of these points into the same cluster. And that this process may bring some new epsilon core points to the cluster, and hence you add all the points within the vicinity of the new core points added to the cluster. And this process, you keep doing this process until the cluster cannot be enlarged anymore. And this is the DB scan cluster. And essentially, you can imagine that a DB scan cluster is spread by the vicinity of the epsilon core points in this cluster. And all these epsilon core points essentially serve as the backbone of the cluster. Here is an example. Let's consider mean point equals 4. When epsilon equals to root 2, then there is only one cluster. All these points are noise. And when epsilon equals to root 10, another cluster appears. This is still a cluster and another one. And when epsilon equals to root 34, there are two clusters. The one is all the points on the left-hand side, and the other one is consists of the points on the right-hand side. And in the optics method, there are also two parameters. The first one is epsilon max, which is the largest epsilon value we are considering. And the second one is mean points, which is exactly the same parameter as DB scan. And the optics diagram of the previous example is as follows. The x-axis enumerates all the points of the dataset, and for each point, we assign a high value of it. And then the y-axis represents the values of epsilon, which is what we say the granularity level here. Now, when epsilon equals to root 2, the value 1 appears, meaning that there is a cluster within of these points. And when epsilon equals to root 10, value 2 appears, meaning that these clusters among these points appears. And so on and so forth. And the best time capacity for computing the optics diagram is factor of n squared. And our result, somehow surprisingly, the value, we say value, we often say value. However, the definition of value is not formally defined yet in the literature. And the first result, we formalize the concept of value first. And then we propose the notion of real approximate optics. The last property of the Rosso corpus is that, first, it has a strong quality guarantee. The values of the real approximate diagram bear only provably small discrepancy to those of the exact one. And second, the rule approximate diagram can be computed in such n log n expected time for constant rho and constant d. Now let us formalize the rarely first. We define a high argumentative permutation of P as a sequence of poor radial pairs, just poor radial pairs, where it satisfies first the radial term we call height. The height is non negative, and all the points in this sequence is just a permutation of P. That means that each part of P appears once and is actually once in the sequence. Clearly, the optics diagram is just a bar chart of this high argumentative permutation, and we call it such a permutation is optics sequence. In the following, we will use optics sequence and optics diagram interchangeably. Now, given a high height value, we define an H value is just a subsequence of the high argumentative permutation. It satisfies three criteria. First, this subsequence must contain at least two pairs. Second, the height of the first pair must be higher than H, and for all the other pairs, must have a height lower than H. Okay? If the last pair in this subsequence is not the last pair in the permutation, meaning that there exists a last pair in the permutation, then the height of the last pair in the permutation must also higher than H. Then you can imagine that the rally essentially is in between two walls, higher than H. But the rally essentially only includes the left wall, exclude the right wall. Okay. Here is an example. P2 and 3 and 4 is a root 10 value because now you have through the diagram, the left wall here, the first pair of the height of P2 is higher than root 10, and all the pairs in P3 and P4 is no higher than root 10, and the last one is higher than root 10 as well. So this is H rally, and so on and so forth. Now let's define the co-distance of point. The co-distance of point is just the distance between the point P and the mean point's nearest neighbor of P. Now you can imagine that essentially the co-distance of P is the small is epsilon value such that P becomes an epsilon co-point in the DB scan definition. And then we define the backbone. The backbone of an H rally is just the set of all the points in this rally with co-distance smaller than or equal to H. This is the backbone definition. Here is an example. This table shows the co-distance of all the points in the period example. Let's focus on these three points. Now, for the root 10 rally P2, P3, and P4, then P2 and P3 are in the backbone of this rally, simply because the co-distance of them are smaller than or equal to the H rally. However, for P4, root 17 is larger than root 10. And so on and so forth. So now we are ready to reveal the connection between the optics and DB scan. First, there is a one-one mapping between the set of the H rallies and the set of DB scan clusters with epsilon equal to H. This is essentially not surprising because as we have already observed that the rallies is each rally corresponds to a DB scan cluster. Second, the backbone of an H rally is precisely the set of all the epsilon components in its corresponding DB scan cluster with the set with epsilon equal to H. And recall that the set of components in a DB scan cluster serve as the backbone of the cluster. And this bullet says that the backbone of the H rally essentially is the backbone of its corresponding DB scan cluster. Therefore, a good approximation to the optics diagram should be able to capture the backbone of the rallies of the exact diagram. So as a result, we define the road approximate optics as follows. Now consider the rho approximate optics is just a sequence, and it's just a high argumentative permutation of P satisfied the following. Now we consider the optics diagram is here. and the lower phosphate Hodgkin's diagram is here. Then for two points in the Hodgkin's diagram, are in the backbone of the same H valley. Then these two points must also be in the backbone of the same H valley in the lower phosphate diagram. Okay. Second, if you find two points in the phosphate diagram are in the backbone of the same H valley, then you must find out that they are also in the backbone of the same H times 1 plus rho value in the Hodgkin's diagram. And we recall that when rho is a small value, say 0.1%, 1 plus rho is just a small perturbation of the value of H. And essentially the lower cosmic optics is just only have a very slight relaxation to the definition of the optics. By this definition, the lower cosmic diagram achieve a very nice rarely preservation guarantee. Now consider that you give me an arbitrary subset of the data set as long as it has at least two points. Then if you can find a H rarely such that its backbone contains all the points of this subset S, then you must be able to find an H rarely in the approximate diagram such that its backbone also contains all the points of S. And second, if you find an H rarely in the approximate diagram whose backbone contains all the points of S, then you must also be able to find an H times 1 plus rho rarely having S in its backbone. So, as you can see that the lower phosphate diagram nicely preserves the backbone. Nicely preserves the backbones of the rallies. Alright. Okay. So here is a simple example. Now consider S is P3, 7, and 8. If you can now as we can see that from this diagram, we can find a root 29 rally whose backbone contains S. Then, by the first bullet, it says that the row approximate diagram must also has a root 29 rally containing S in the backbone. Here, indeed, it has. And similarly, for the second for S equal to 6, P6, 7, and 9, if you can as we can find a root 8 rally containing S in the backbone, then by the second bullet, you must be able to find 1.0001 times root 8 rally in the approximate in the exact Hodgkin's diagram whose backbone contains S. And the last example is just a negative implication of the two bullets. And I due to the time limitation, I skip it here. And then what's more, another nice property of neural cosmic optics is that it can be computed in just backbone of n log n time for constant dimensionality d and constant rho. And thank you.
But if you directly use the HDB scan, you cannot
you cannot easily find that unless you transfer it into some kind of this nice cycle.